Find out how to rock early admission at Universal's Islands of Adventure like a pro. This is Go Inform Podcast, episode 26. Hey, everybody, welcome to the show. This is episode 26, and today we are talking about early admission at Universal Islands of Adventure. So thank you so much again for joining me here on the Go Inform podcast. My name is Maven. I am the founder of the website goinform.net, and I am here to help you have the best vacation ever. So thanks for joining me today. Today we are talking about early admission at Universal Orlando's Islands of Adventure theme park. And I hope that this really helps you get a better plan together for your morning over at Islands of Adventure. The show notes for today's episode will be over at goinform.net/26. And this topic, actually, about early admission at Islands of Adventure, I have a post that I wrote a while back that's all about this as well. So I will make sure and link to that in the show notes. And also anything else that I mentioned here that I think would be helpful for you to know when you're getting ready for your early morning over there, I will put that in the show notes too. So again, that's at the website, goinform.net/26. So early admission at Universal Orlando is the chance for guests who are staying on site in any of the on-site hotels to enter at least one of the theme parks every morning an hour before the general public can. This is a really great way to make the most of your time at Universal Orlando. You're able to get into the park before the big crowds are there, and you can really experience, especially the Wizarding World of Harry Potter, with low crowds and see it without it just being packed full of people, which is really great. So on the on-site hotels at Universal Orlando are the Portofino Bay, the Hard Rock Hotel, the Royal Pacific Resort, Sapphire Falls, Cabana Bay, and the Aventura. And Universal actually is also in the process of building two more resorts over there. So there will be more people that are going to be able to use early admission, and not all of them are going to take advantage of it. But definitely it helps if you have an idea of what to expect when you're going to go for early admission, because even though you have lower crowds at this time in the morning, there's still people there. And if you have a few tips for how to best navigate this, then you're going to be ahead even of that crowd. So you guys can really do it up and walk right in there like a pro. So that's the idea of today's episode, is to help you have that insight so that you can really make the most of this hour. I mean, if you're going to get up early, and it can be quite early, you want to know what to do when you get there so you can make it really worthwhile. So guests staying in those on-site hotels get early admission, and actually some of the hotels at Universal also give another perk, which is a free express pass for everyone who's staying in your room. And this is something that I really recommend that you look into as well. I'm not going to get really into that today, but I did talk a lot about it in the second episode of this podcast. In Go Informed, episode number 2 was about where to stay when you go to Universal Orlando. So if you want to have some more insight about the hotels on site and kind of the pros and cons of where to stay, make sure that you go back and listen to that episode. I think it'll give you more insight about all of the different perks that you get for staying on site and why you might want to consider it. And even if you book your hotel, it doesn't really matter how you book it. If you book your hotel on your own through Universal's website, if you book it through a travel agent, if you book it through another site like booking.com or Expedia or any of those, everybody that's staying in those on-site hotels gets this early admission perk. So don't feel like you have to book it through Universal or through some kind of package. No matter how you got there, if you are staying in one of those hotels, you're going to have early admission. And the only other people really that are going to ever get to be part of this early admission are some annual pass holders. They have some perks that allows them sometimes to take advantage of early admission. But for the most part, you're just talking about, you know, the guests that are staying on site, the guests who are staying on site who decided to get up early. So it's a pretty, relatively small crowd that you're talking about who will be in the park with you. Now, one thing that you're going to want to know when you are planning for your trip is to find out which park is going to be open early during the time that you're there. Because a lot of the times, Universal will only open one of the parks for early admission. And a lot of times, it's not like it switches every day. It's usually for maybe a whole month or a few weeks. It's only one park or the other. So make sure you take a look at the Universal early admission calendar before you get there to Florida so you can be thinking about what kind of strategy you're going to want to have for your morning. I will put a link to that calendar in the show notes because sometimes it's kind of hard to find it on Universal's website. And make sure you take a look at that. Now, sometimes both parks are open early, and if you see this, this means it's going to be busy because they're not going to staff two parks early for just low crowds. So if you're going at a time when you see both parks are open early, especially if you see a very early opening time, this is a cue that you really need to take advantage of this because it's a sign that these theme parks are going to be really busy later in the day. So again, I highly encourage you to try this out. Even if you just try it one of the days that you're staying there, give it a try because it can be a super productive part of your day, a super productive part of your whole trip. And it's really worth giving it a go to see what it's like and to see if it's going to work for you. Early admission in the theme parks at Universal is a limited early admission. So what I mean by that is that the entire park is not actually open early, just part of it is. And at Islands of Adventure, the part that's open early is the Hogsmeade Village part of the Wizarding World of Harry Potter. So this one, for you guys who are Harry Potter fans, and if that is one of the main reasons you're coming to Universal, then this is for you because you guys are getting this extra like kind of VIP treatment in the Wizarding World. And even if Harry Potter isn't your main thing, you may still want to take advantage of this because in some ways, this might be even more geared towards you because you, if you're not a Harry Potter fan, then going through there when it's super packed and it's really hot and, you know, all of that, that's going to make Hogsmeade Village definitely not be your favorite. But if you can walk in there when it's low crowds, you can hear the music, you can really see, look in the shop windows, you can experience the rides without long waits, then I think that for people who aren't hardcore fans, that actually is going to be way more enjoyable. And I think you are going to enjoy it if you can do it without those big crowds. So don't just write it off if Harry Potter isn't your top thing. This can still be a really great thing to take advantage of, and it gets you in the park early so you could actually get over and be first in the line for whatever other rides you want to do at Islands of Adventure too. Okay, so some logistical things to know about early admission over at Universal. Okay, the first thing is that you need to get to the gate about 30 minutes before the time it says it's going to open. And let me talk a little bit about what time we're talking about here. So normally, the Universal parks open at 9 o'clock in the morning. On most times of the year, that's going to be the typical opening time. So that means that early admission is going to be at 8 o'clock. Now, once in a while, the parks are opening at 8 in the morning. If you go over a holiday weekend or if you go during a really peak time in summer, you're going to see those park hours get extended and even the regular opening time is going to be 8 in the morning, which means early admissions at 7. So I know that is early and now I'm telling you to get there 30 minutes before that, but you know what? Most people won't get up that early. So if you see a 7 o'clock early admission time, that is actually really good for you. If you can get there, you're going to be really in a small crowd. I mean, not even relatively speaking, like it's going to be a small crowd. So take a look, make sure you know what time the park's going to open, because if you assume a certain thing and it's actually opening an hour earlier, then you just got up what you thought was early and you didn't even get the perk of the extra hour. So again, make sure and take a look at that calendar. Look at it before, not too far in advance of your trip too, just to make sure nothing has changed with that calendar. And usually when you check in at the hotel, they're also going to give you the time. So just be aware that it might be earlier than you think. Sorry, guys. So you're going to want to get there even earlier than whatever time they say it's opening, because it isn't going to open at that time. The parks at Universal almost always open about 15 minutes before whatever time they say the park opens. So if we're talking about an 8 a.m. early admission time, they're probably going to be letting people through the gates right about 7:45. So don't arrive at 8 because everybody is already going to be in there. Get there at 7:30 and then you can get in line and you will be one of the first people in the park. If you literally want to be the first person in the park, get there about 7:15, 7:20. Usually if you arrive 45 minutes before the opening time, you'll be one of the first people there. So just to give you an idea, you guys, about how that works. And incidentally, it's the same with regular time. If you're just going not at early admission and you want to go when the park opens, same thing. You want to get there early. And I have a bunch of advice about that in episode 7, which is all about your first day at the Universal Parks. So that's when I really recommend you listen to after you're done with this one, because I also talk about how you get through the turnstile with your ticket and all of that stuff. And you're going to want to know that so that it doesn't slow you down. Because the whole idea here, guys, is just to keep it moving, because the eyes on the prize is being one of the first people in Hogsmeade Village on that day. So a couple things you're going to want to bring with you for early admission. One, obviously, is your park ticket. So make sure everybody in your group has their park ticket. If you are planning to go over to Universal Studios on the same day, if you want to take the Hogwarts Express and go to Diagon Alley, which we're going to talk about in just a minute here, then you need a two-park ticket. I think that's either called a two-park ticket or sometimes park-to-park ticket. That will allow you admission into both parks on the same day. I highly recommend springing for the extra $10 a day or whatever. It's not that much to get a ticket that allows you into both parks, because it's going to allow you to switch between the parks depending on the crowd level and also just depending on what you feel like doing. It's really easy to go between the two parks at Universal. So really consider getting a ticket that allows you to do that on the same day. So bring your ticket, obviously. Don't forget it, you guys. Everybody does that, especially early in the morning. So make sure everyone has their ticket. The other thing you need is your room key. So when you check in to the hotel at Universal, the front desk is going to make a key for every person in your group. I mean, unless they're a toddler, everybody, including little kids, is going to have a room key with their name on it. It has your name, it has your hotel name, and it has the dates that you're staying. And this is your early admission ticket. So when you come to the park for early admission, what's going to happen is you're going to they'll scan your park ticket and let you through the turnstile. And then as you're walking into the park, there'll be park employees there, and they're going to ask you to hold up your room key so they can tell that you actually deserve to be in there for early admission. So if someone in your group doesn't have their room key, that's going to be a problem. So make sure that everybody has their key, and then also keep it somewhere handy so that once you get through the turnstile, you don't have to stop and try to find it. And everybody's like, I can't remember where I put it. Don't do that, because again, we're all about efficiency, and you want to be able to just hold it up and show it and walk past. And, you know, actually, I'm going to keep referencing back to these episodes so much. You guys should really go back and listen to the first 7 episodes in the podcast, because they're all about what to expect at Universal Orlando. And one of the things that I talk about in one of those, or probably multiple episodes, is having a lanyard that you can keep your room key in and your and anything else that you might have, like your express pass and your park ticket. Because if you've got one of these lanyards, you can just have your park ticket facing one way and you can have your room key facing the other way. And all you have to do is just, it's around your neck and you just hold it up while you're walking into the park for early admission. It makes it super easy, and it makes it easy to remember that you have it. You always know where it is. So that's just a little bit of a tip, especially if you're going to be there for more than one morning. Having a lanyard that keeps it all really organized is a great thing to have. Okay, so now we're in the park. It's not 8 o'clock yet. I'm just assuming we have an 8 o'clock early admission. So you've gotten into the park, it's about 7:45 or so. You show your room key to the park attendant. What's going to happen is there's going to be sort of one way through the park to get back to Hogsmeade, and they'll sort of corral the guests. So the way that you're going to walk through the park is going to be as you walk in, and there's a lake in front of you, and to the left is the Hulk roller coaster. You're actually going to go to the right and go around the lake that's the center of Islands of Adventure. Yeah, don't ask me why the islands are around the lake. I already talked about that in episode 4, which is the Islands of Adventure tour, another one that you guys ought to listen to. So you're going to walk to the right. You're going to go through Seuss Landing and through a few other things as you walk around this lake. And eventually you're going to end up in Hogsmeade Village. And in terms of how they kind of hold, if do they hold people back and so forth, sometimes they will stop the early admission guests for a few minutes. Usually it's kind of right at the beginning by Seuss Landing. And that's just if they're not quite ready for you back in Hogsmeade yet. But most of the time over at Islands of Adventure, you can walk through the gate and walk right, just walk fast and walk right through Seuss Landing all the way up to Hogsmeade Village. And the big draw in Hogsmeade Village is, of course, Hogwarts Castle. So as you're walking into the village, there's going to be nobody else there, which is super cool. You will hear the music, the Harry Potter music, and see all the shops and all the cool stuff in Hogsmeade. And if you don't want to ride the Harry Potter, the big thrill ride that's in this part of the park, then you can just explore to your heart's content here in Hogsmeade. But I think what we're going to do is we're just going to make a beeline for the castle. So inside of Hogwarts Castle is the Harry Potter and the Forbidden Journey ride. This is a super cool ride, you guys. You get to, it's like you're riding on a broomstick. You get to go play Quidditch with Harry. You get chased by a lot of stuff. Okay, it can be scary for littler kids. I will put a link in the show notes to my post about using the child swap option at these rides so that you can test it out before you send your kid or even your friend or someone else who might be afraid of some of the stuff in this ride. So if you think you've got somebody who may be afraid to ride it, make sure you look in the show notes and read my post about that because I've got some advice for you. But generally speaking, this is a really fun ride. It is a very unique experience because it does feel like you're flying and it's the ride system's really interesting. So it's very, very cool. But actually, the ride isn't the only thing that's cool inside the castle. The castle itself is super cool. You get to see Dumbledore's office. You get to see classrooms. You get to see the paintings on the wall that are talking to each other. Like, there's just tons of really interesting detail. Oh, the sorting hat's in there, talks to you. So there's a whole ton of really cool stuff inside the castle. And when you get there first, there's a couple things. You may just want to be first person on the ride, and I'll give you some tips about that in just a sec. But if that's not as important to you as just experiencing the whole thing and really getting to see the castle, this is an awesome time to just take your time through the queue, let people pass you, and really take it in because, again, you're going to have the whole place to yourself. So you can really experience it like a VIP. It's really cool. So in terms of being the first one on the ride at the Forbidden Journey ride, a couple things to know. Okay, the first one is when you walk into this ride, when you walk into the castle, if you have anything that you can't zip into a pocket, like if you have bags, purses, backpacks, hat, your phone that doesn't fit in your pocket, make sure you zip it in if you put it in a pocket, because this ride, it turns you every which direction. You're totally going to lose stuff. So if you have anything loose, you have to put it in a locker before you get on the ride. So the lockers, there's a couple of locker rooms, and right when you walk in the entrance to your right is going to be where the locker rooms are. There's going to be people there telling you, put your stuff in the locker, it's over here. So you're going to have to go and get a locker. So send one person from your group in there to stick the stuff in the locker so you don't cram up the whole locker room, and then go ahead and get in the line. So if you can go into the park in the morning with nothing that needs to go in a locker, that is one way that you can be the first person on the ride because you won't have to stop. Most people have to stop, put their stuff in the locker, which means that if you do too, you will still be one of the first on the ride because everybody else had to stop too. So it's not like they're all passing you by, even though it might seem that way. So, but just so you know, you do have to put your stuff in a locker while you ride. The lockers are free. Again, I talk about that a lot in the early episodes of the podcast. So you can listen to those to hear more about it. So you're going to put your stuff in a locker or not, and jump into the line. Now, if you have an express pass, if you're staying in one of the hotels that gives you an express pass, or you may have bought an express pass, there is an express pass line for the Harry Potter and the Forbidden Journey ride. So you can go, even during early admission, you can get in that express pass line, and that will take you up to the front of the line, like faster pretty much faster than any other way that you're going to get through the castle. So that is one way that you might be able to be the first person on the ride. If you don't have an express pass, you might still be, because if you were one of the first to get in the park and you walk really fast, like how my daughter walks, oh my gosh, they say no running, but I kind of have to run to catch up to her. Then you may still be like first person in there, and you can just go in the regular line and just, you can come back later and look at Dumbledore's office and stuff and just buzz right through. And the other thing that's inside Hogwarts Castle is a single rider line. They don't usually have it opened for the first wave of guests, but by the time, if you ride the ride once and come off and you want to go back in and ride again, a lot of times by that second or maybe third time around, the singles line is open. And the singles line bypasses most of the interesting stuff in the castle. It's a really kind of a back way into the castle, but it's a really quick line, and they often go really fast through their singles if they have single riders. So that's another way that you can really get up into the front quickly. As you can maybe tell by how I'm describing this, you can ride the Forbidden Journey ride multiple times in those first few minutes of the day if you're using early admission. So this is a really, really good reason to get up early and get to Islands of Adventure first thing, because you can get on the ride and ride it really early, be one of the first people on, get off, and just go right back through the entrance, go right back in the line, and still have a really short wait even that second time through, ride it again, then hop in the singles line. I mean, you guys, you can ride the Forbidden Journey ride pretty much as many times as you want in that first hour that the park's open. And don't forget that, as I mentioned, the park usually opens, you know, like 15 minutes or so before the official stated time. So you can, even though you have to walk through the park, I mean, the Hogsmeade Village is in the back of the park, but even though you have to make that walk and stop at a locker, you may still, you probably will still be able to ride Forbidden Journey and get off of it by 8 o'clock. Like, by the time the park was supposed to open, you could have already ridden it. And by like 8:20 or 8:30, you could easily ride it three times. So if you come back on a lot of these days and you want to ride it at 10 o'clock in the morning or 2 in the afternoon or 5 in the evening, in the amount of time that you're going to spend riding it three times, you might not even make it halfway through the line. I mean, this is a ride that, even though it's not a brand new ride, it's super popular, and it easily has 90-minute wait times all the time. So you can either come back later and wait an hour and a half to ride it once, or get up early and ride it three times in a half hour. So that just gives you some perspective about how powerful early admission can be. Okay, so if you didn't want to ride Forbidden Journey for some reason, you know, I still recommend that you walk through the castle. You can go and walk through the entire queue and check it all out and get up to the front and just say, I don't want to ride, I just wanted to see the castle. People do it all the time, and they'll just say, okay, here's the way out. So I do recommend, if you're a Harry Potter fan and you know that you can't ride this ride for any reason, go check out the castle. And it's not scary in there either. If you have little kids who, if they've seen any of the first couple of Harry Potter movies and they weren't scared of that, then they'll probably enjoy walking through there too. So you can always just go through, check it out, and then go out and enjoy some of the rest of Hogsmeade Village. And Hogsmeade Village, first thing in the morning like this, it's really a wonderful time to slow down and check out all the details in the windows. If you have an interactive wand, you can do the magic spells that are all throughout Hogsmeade Village, and you can pretty much walk up to any window during early admission and there won't be anyone else doing spells, so you can have that place to yourself. So if you don't want to do the ride in the castle, that's where almost everybody who's coming in with you, they're all going to disappear into that castle. So you can have the whole rest of the place to yourself if you don't want to ride. The other thing that's a really good use of early admission at Hogsmeade Village is to do the tour at the Ollivander's Wand Shop. It's kind of a show where you go in and Ollivander is there and he talks about the shop, and somebody from the people who are in there gets chosen for a wand to choose them. And it's a lot like that scene in the first movie where Harry gets his wand, and it's really cool. I think everybody should check this out at some point while you're there. It's really well done. It's the shop, the detailing in the shop is really cool. It's super fun. But the thing about Ollivander's is it's small, and what they do is they just let a certain amount of people in at once, and then those people get to see the show and then they go. And so it's like can't be even 50 people at a time that go in there. So the line for this can get really long and it moves really, really slowly. So first thing in the morning, if that is a priority for you to go to Ollivander's, that might be what you want to do with your very first thing in Hogsmeade Village. Just go and line up at Ollivander's. There might not even be obviously a place to line up if you're one of the first people in there, but just line up in front of the door and get that done first, because then you won't waste time in line for that later, and you can go and see Ollivander, and then you're gonna have to get a wand after that. And so you can get your wand and then you can go do magic around Hogsmeade. So this is really fun too if you have maybe a younger kid and an older kid with you, and the younger one's not gonna ride Forbidden Journey, but the older one wants to ride it all day long. You know, the older one can go and do that, and the younger one and you can go in and do the Ollivander experience, and then they can do their magic around while they're waiting for their big brother or whatever. So that's another really cool thing that you can do in Hogsmeade Village, and that really is worth doing first thing in the morning. Another attraction in Hogsmeade that you might be wondering about is called the Flight of the Hippogriff. This is a little kid roller coaster sort of thing. Personally, I don't think it's really very worth doing at any time of the day, unless you have really little kids, except that Hagrid's hut is back there. So at some point later during the day when you're just want to walk around, you can go check that out. But I would skip Flight of the Hippogriff during your early admission time. It's not worth taking the time to do it then. It's much better to go to the attractions that are going to have a really big line later in the day and do those during your early admission time. And I should mention too, other stuff that I wouldn't use for early admission, at least, would be shopping and eating. So I recommend that you have a little something to eat, like on your way to the park, so your stomach's not empty, but don't stop and eat during this first hour, because you can do that in another hour when there's more people around and, you know, it's a little more like the normal part of the day. And shopping, same thing. I know the shops get crowded in Hogsmeade Village, but you can shop with, you know, any time of day, no matter how crowded it is, the lines, I mean, you can put up with a 5-minute wait at the line for shopping, but a 90-minute wait for Forbidden Journey, I don't like that. So I always want to use my early admission time for those things that are really going to take a lot of time and then come back later and just at a leisurely pace. That's when you can do your shopping or go and get your butter beer or whatever you want. And heck, you guys, you can do that at 9:30 even once the park gates open. It's going to start getting more crowded, but it's fine because you will have already, you know, satisfied your need to do these other things first because you've done those from the very start of your day. So we've talked about a few things that you can do at the beginning of your time in Hogsmeade Village. Now, what do you do after you get off Forbidden Journey or after you've been to Ollivander's and done some spells? Well, one thing that you can do is you can take the Hogwarts Express train and go over to Diagon Alley in Universal Studios, Florida. So as I mentioned before, a lot of times only one of the Universal parks is open for early admission during your stay. And usually, you know, like I said, it's not alternating. So you might be staying at a Universal for a few days, but every one of those days, your early admission is in Islands of Adventure. So you never have the chance to get over to Diagon Alley during early admission because Universal Studios Florida, it's just opening at their regular time. So one thing that you can do is you can leverage your early admission at Islands of Adventure to get into Diagon Alley at the very start of the day over there. So here's how you can do it. Okay, first of all, if the only thing you care about is getting over to Diagon Alley and being one of the first people in Diagon Alley and on Gringotts Bank and all of that, then what you want to do is when you come into Hogsmeade Village, you need to go straight to the Hogwarts Express and you need to get in line over there because that is what's going to take you over to Diagon Alley. Now, the Hogwarts Express starts running. It runs between Islands of Adventure and Universal Studios Florida. It runs between Hogsmeade Village and Diagon Alley. So this is your ticket. It's kind of your backdoor entrance over into Universal Studios. So this train starts running. Normally, they start letting people in and queuing up about, like, if it's a 9 o'clock opening time over at Universal Studios, they're going to usually start moving the line into the Hogwarts Express at about 8:30. So if you don't go on Forbidden Journey or you just skip everything else in Hogsmeade and you go over there and you stake out a spot at the start of the line at Hogwarts Express right at 8 o'clock, you're going to be like the first person on the train whenever it goes. So that train, like I said, they'll start letting people in around 8:30. And I think the first train usually leaves and heads over to Diagon Alley at about 8:40 or so. And that will put you in the park at Universal Studios Florida just a little bit before 9 o'clock. Just like with early admission, regular admission, they allow the guests in usually about 15 minutes before park opens. So if you arrive over in King's Cross Station and you're walking over there to Diagon Alley, you're going to be getting back there just a little bit before 9 o'clock, which will be almost exact same time as the guests who came in from the front gate at regular admission time. That's about the same time they're going to get back there. So it will be as if you waited for the park to open over at Universal Studios Florida, but you may beat the crowd because you may actually be just ahead of them, or you might be in them, but you're still going to be right with the very, very first people who are getting into Diagon Alley. Now, as I mentioned, the Hogwarts Express train doesn't actually start loading or anything till around 8:30. So if you don't care if you're on the very first train or the very first person, but you still want to get over to Diagon Alley in that first wave, then what you can do is you can come into Hogsmeade, just like we talked about to begin with, go ride Forbidden Journey, maybe even ride it twice, especially if you have an express pass or if you ride the second time on the singles line. Just get done with that ride by about 8:15 or 8:30 and go over and get in the Hogwarts express line. You won't be the first person in line probably, because there will be people who that's their top priority, but you will be on the first or second train over to Universal Studios Florida, and you will be one of the first people in that park, even though you were first in this park and you've already ridden the ride inside Hogwarts Castle. So it is really amazing what you can accomplish in this first hour. You can really be, you know, absolutely first in Hogsmeade Village and one of the first in Diagon Alley all in the same morning. So it's super cool, you guys. It's a really, really good way to use that first hour. And as you come out of the train station at King's Cross, you're just going to take a left and head towards Diagon Alley. There will be people back there at Universal Studios who will be directing you. If there's a line already started for the Gringotts Bank, they'll tell you where to go. And if you're planning to do this, I do recommend that you go back a couple of episodes ago. In episode 23, I talked about early admission at Universal Studios Florida. I recommend that you give that a listen, because it's going to give you an idea of sort of how they funnel people into Diagon Alley when it first opens and into that Gringotts Bank ride. So get yourself familiar with what's happening there first thing in the morning so that you know what to expect and don't get mixed. You don't want to get mixed up. You don't want to make it that far and make a wrong turn and not end up where you want to be. So get educated about what to expect over there too. But that is a really fun. I just think it's super cool to be first in Hogsmeade Village and one of the first in Diagon Alley all before, you know, it's like all before 9 o'clock. You get to do all this cool stuff. And then you have the whole rest of the day to do all the other stuff in the parks. And for the most part, the busiest parts of these parks are the Wizarding World sections. So you are taking care of all of that at the lowest crowd levels of the day. And then you get to go into the other parts of the park, which will take a while to get crowded. So the rest of your morning can be really quite leisurely. And for me, it really helps knowing that I already ticked off my kind of some of my really big ticket attractions that I wanted to see. So not worried about how am I going to fit that in later, because it's already done. The other thing you can do after you're finished with the Forbidden Journey ride or the Ollivander's experience or whatever you really wanted to do in Hogsmeade Village is, if there is something else in Islands of Adventure that's really important that you really want to get on at least once, maybe you want to ride it a few times, and it's a ride that often gets a line, then what you can do is around 8:30, probably even more like 8:40, you could start walking to that attraction and get in the line over there, because they're going to start opening the main gate at Islands of Adventure at around 8:45, which means all the other attractions will start opening up right around that time. So if you want to ride the Hulk coaster with very low lines, or Spider-Man, or the Kong ride, those are all going to start opening up just a little bit before 9 o'clock. And if you're already in the park, so you can start walking over there early and be like first in line for those rides. So there really is a lot that you can do besides just the Hogsmeade stuff with that first hour. So I hope that I've convinced you guys to get up and try it out. You probably think I'm like a total morning person. I'm like in the army and get up at 5 o'clock every day and try to get everything done by 9 o'clock. That's really not true. Actually, I'm not like that. And We just figured out, though, that it really, this is one of those times when you just have to do it. So because I'm not really that much of a morning person, I've thought of a lot of tips and tricks and hacks to get us out of bed and to the parks in time. And I've written a blog post about this, and episode 19 of this podcast is all about that. So if you want some tips about how to actually, how to get there for a, you know, 8 o'clock or even a 7 o'clock early admission, like how do you make this happen? Go back a couple episodes, look for my episode called Master Your Theme Park Morning. And that one is going to help you to navigate all of the tricks that will help you get there early. And I think it will make it a little bit easier for you. So go back and check that episode out. And hopefully that'll help you get up early enough so you can be there. Yeah, mornings is a recurring theme here on the podcast. In fact, I think the next episode is going to be about mornings in Disney World. So, yeah, that's why I decided to put that episode about how to get up kind of early on here, because I figured I would end up referencing that a lot. So stay tuned for more advice about mornings. All right. Well, I think that pretty much wraps up what I wanted to tell you about early admission over at Islands of Adventure. Again, I will put links to all that stuff. I'll put links to my post about getting up early and plenty of other information for you about it all in the show notes. Those will be at goinform.net/26. And so go ahead and go over there and get the rest of the information too. And I want to give a special shout out to all of you guys who have written reviews for me on iTunes and on wherever it is you like to write reviews or where you're listening to this podcast. It's really cool to read what you guys are writing. And it's especially great for people who are exploring and trying to figure out if they want to listen, and it helps everybody find the podcast. So thank you to all of you. I'm going to try to give you guys a shout out over on Facebook when I see any of the reviews. So watch the Facebook page. You can find me. I'm just goinform.net over on Facebook. So keep an eye over there. I apologize if I don't see your review. Sometimes if you're in another country or on a different app or whatever, I miss it. Take a screenshot and send it to me, you guys. You can message me on Facebook or whatever. I love to see it and I love to hear from you. So again, thanks to everybody who's made that effort, and to all of you guys who are thinking about it, thank you in advance for your reviews. It's awesome. And thank you for listening. And I will see you next time on the show. And I really hope you have a thrilling vacation.